second overall pick, Howie Roseman and company are poised to make a move that could make or break them for several years for the Eagles franchise. With that, we welcome our next guest for our big talk of the day from PhillyInfluencer.com, Sean Brace. Good morning, Sean.
Hey, good morning, guys.
What's up, bro?
It's draft week. It's exciting. That's what it's all about right now. That's all we have, really, to tell you the truth.
Especially after yesterday's
fine.
So let's look at it. Big move, bold move this week, certainly. And one that wasn't unexpected. We had heard that they were interested in possibly moving up, but to pull the trigger and give up what they gave up.
Yeah.
Sets up kind of a unique situation now if it is Wentz and Bradford and Chase Daniel, but you look at what the Eagles gave up, what they got back in return. You're essentially flipping picks in 16 at one, right? You get a fourth back, which kind of recoup the 16-4 that you lose. So it's a 1-2 and a 3, essentially, that they gave up.
Yeah, and next year's going to stay. It's that first round over there, first round selection next year will stay, but bottom line is the Eagles were able to get to 8th. Removing the contracts of DeMarco Murray, Maxwell, Kiko Alonso, guys we didn't think would be possible. Move from 8 to 2, and Howie Rose, we heard what he said, where he's speaking about number of quarterbacks in the upcoming drafts, won't be there, so they had to take a shot at these two guys. I have no problem with the Eagles doing this. I don't. My question is just how good is Carson Wentz? I think we're all on that same page right now. I look at that offense.
Like, theoretically, you got to get your quarterback if you don't feel like Bradford is the guy who can win you a Super Bowl, right?
Yep.
Theoretically, right. But this, you're right. That's what it comes down to. What exactly do you have here in Carson Wentz?
Yeah, Carson Wentz, and just remember how good North Dakota State, for the people that don't know, 5 straight national championships at the 1AA level. He replaced the quarterback that won it 3 straight years. They run a little bit of a gimmick style offense. I know people want to argue that with me, but the guy averaged 9 rushes per game his junior year. I mean, that's a little bit of a gimmick style offense to me.
That's why he's only played 7 games last year. He ran that type of gimmick offense. Yeah. He's running the ball too much. Not a Cam Newton, and that's what they want him to be, a Cam Newton type of player. The difference between the 1AA and Division I football is speed. Players are bigger, stronger, and faster. Yeah. That means a lot when you're going to Buffalo level. So just like when you're from high school level to college level, it's also a huge jump from the college level to the pro level. And he's going to take more of a jump than all these quarterbacks made last year. I mean, they definitely are.
See, to me, I feel like a lot of people, you know, ourselves included, we talked about this, a lot of people fear the unknown with Carson Wentz because there's just not much footage. There's 23 games from his college career that they have on tape that you can watch him and you can break down some of the plays, and you've seen some of them. To me, the bigger issue is everything that you gave up in order to get him, in order to get this unknown, when you still have a lot of holes to fill. That's my issue, is how are you going to fill the rest of these holes? Because, great, you may have a quarterback, but guess what? If you don't have, you know, your correct
offensive line in order. If Jason Peters goes down, then what? Is always my follow-up to this. What happens then? And you could say that about a lot of teams if they lose their starting left tackle.
Yeah.
In trouble. But we knew that this was coming. Like, if he goes down, it's not a surprise. And shame on anybody who says, oh, my gosh,
Jason Peters went down. He couldn't make it through 2 games in a row last season.
Yeah, I mean, Dennis Scott.
One thing that might come for you, and I saw this over the weekend, I don't know if you guys caught this, but the mock drafts are all over the place. And I was watching, forget what channel it was, but like I said, they're all over the place. And it had Vernon Hargraves, who is a cornerback out of Florida, who people were talking about at 8 overall, going 30th.
Yeah.
30th now. So are we really going to hold up going out there and getting a quarterback over a possible talented cornerback that you possibly could get at the end of the first round?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the quarterbacks right now in this year's draft, there's a lot of uncertainty with that.
Sure.
So I would feel better. I would have felt better even last year with Jameis Winston or Marcus Mariota. If that were the case, you know what you're getting. You knew more than that.
But teams aren't going to give up these franchise. But if you don't have to question whether or not these guys are franchise quarterbacks, they're not going to be available. You know, and that's what it was with Jameis Winston.
So you feel comfortable giving up everything that this team gave up in order to go for an unknown?
Look.
An uncertain, I'll say.
Nothing is really screaming at me that Carson Wentz will be a stud at the next level. But I have no problem with the Eagles package, what they did, spreading out the picks. And again, you want to look at the Washington Redskins, what they did a couple years ago when we all harp on this. We all go to it. Look what they gave up. They got it wrong by going after RG3. Mm-hmm. Oh, they gave up 3 first-round selections, a couple other picks. And what did they do the last 4 years? They won the division 2 out of the last 4 years.
Well, here's what they did that was really smart. They sort of hedged their bets, and they took Kirk Cousins in the fourth round, which was really, if you look back now, a really smart move.
Absolutely. Yeah, we thought it was idiotic for a while.
I thought it was going to be a straight flip. Yep. You know, you get him for a year or two, groom him, maybe gets a shot here and there, and then you trade him. And then it turns out he's their guy.
Man, we don't know what the Eagles will do. I mean, Chase Daniel, you know.
Would you be comfortable with Goff?
Oh, I told you guys right from Jump Street that I'm a Goff guy. I think Goff, hands down, is the best quarterback in this draft. I think he can sling it. His accuracy is there. Look at his red zone numbers. They're off the charts. I'm a Goff guy. I don't know if he'll be successful out in LA because it seems like they really just want to pack the new stadium that they're building there. So I don't know what their deal is, but I think Goff will be successful at the next level.
Goff, I think, has a higher learning curve at this point. You know, he has learned a lot more because he hasn't read any defenses. He didn't understand that conceptually yet. I mean, he ran a spread offense. He didn't go from under center. There's a lot of things. Both of these quarterbacks.
Sure, but he's going to be thrown to the wolves back. I mean, this isn't going to be. Yeah. He's not going to be groomed for Case Keenum.
Yeah.
Or Nick Foles. He's going to be playing.
That's if they get him. That's the thing. You know, I mean, like I said, Fisher has always been a guy that he likes guys like McNair. And Goff isn't nowhere near
as big and physical as him. He's a throw.
So you go with Wentz. I'm just thinking Wentz now.
You think, despite everything we're hearing, do you think the Eagles would make this move? Now, granted, nothing's concrete.
Mm-hmm.
But do you think the Eagles would make this move with this risk that, hey, we're in love with Wentz and Rams are telling us it's Goff, but the Rams could turn around and then...
The Rams don't give a damn about what Philadelphia's doing on this side.
I agree with you.
It's like we're on a total different side of the earth.
Look, we're in the same boat. And yeah. I know everybody's... We're all assuming, right?
Yeah, we're assuming.
Well, the agent has something to do with this.
It sure does. The same one. Yep. But it's not a done deal until it's a done
totally
deal.
Totally agree with you.
Right. Yeah.
And I will be okay with it. If all of a sudden...
I like Goff a lot. And I understand what you're saying.
You like Goff.
I've said that from the jump, too. I understand there's a more of a learning curve to the NFL game and all that. But I look at a guy who did it for a lot of years, 3+ years at Cal.
Yeah, and that's the biggest thing right there. Yes.
Incredibly productive quarterback there, no matter what the system was.
He was only Pac-12. He was second team Pac-12. That's the only thing, man. You look at things, he was Pac-12 one year. All Pac-12 one year. When you're,
but they're not a great team, and I think that hurt him a little bit. And his defense, when he took that team over, they were horrendous.
What's going to be interesting is...
I'm just saying, when I was a rookie. I mean, I was my freshman
Kansas
year.
State was awful.
Kansas State, we were awful, mm-hmm. And I was still first team All Big Eight.
What's going to be interesting is if Sam Bradford gets hurt this year, which he does every single year. What happens if he goes down for 3 to 4 to 5 weeks? I don't want to hear Chase Daniel.
Well, we are going to hear.
We're going to hear Chase
Daniel.
Week 9,
week 10.
No,
I don't want to hear Chase Daniel.
But the thing is, that's what we're stuck with then, because whoever they get, either Carson Wentz or Jared Goff, neither of those guys is going to be ready to go this season. They're not.
Yeah.
Well, so, sorry. I mean, we could have.
Look, everything looks great on this paper. Everything looks great on paper.
Paper always looks good.
They know it's a project. They do.
Yeah.
All right. So, with all four of the major teams making some big changes this year, we wanted to play a new game, and we call it Wit or Without. We're going to run through each team, starting with the Eagles, okay? So you're...
Here we go.
That's right.
Our game show contender here.
Oh,
will they be Wit or Without Sam Bradford at the start of next season?
I have to say, it's say Wit. Like you just said, there's a plan. They have it on paper. Sam is the starter. Chase is the backup. And then all of a sudden, you're going to bring in Carson Wentz. He's going to be a third string. He's going to learn. I'm going to say Wit. Week one, Sam Bradford.
That's why, you know, I know people are like, oh, it's a foregone conclusion. They're going to take Wentz and make draft night four. And no, it doesn't. There could be so many different
Very
deals
true.
That go down. It could be unbelievable.
And second
thing.
Pick, Laramie
Humphreys. Yes. Ezekiel Elliott. All right, so next up, we're going to the Flyers. Will they win a Stanley Cup with or without Claude Giroux? As the best non-playing goalie on their team.
Another playoff series where he just disappears. What, he led the team in points this year? I just don't know what happens. They're just able to take him out of the fold. Get out of here. I don't want to hear it, Sarah. This is my segment. I think times are going to change. I think you got to start looking to make some moves.
I'm calling you on a fact that you got wrong.
What?
You ready?
What?
You just said... Another playoff series in which Claude Giroux doesn't show up. Shall I read you the evidence? Well, he has 62 points in 62 games, even after this series, where he had just 1 point. In 09-10, 21 points in 23 games.
No, the Rangers series and this series, the back-to-back, these last two series. Where was he?
He had 6
where
points.
Where was Claude?
He had 6 points in 7 games in the Rangers series.
I totally disagree with that.
Nice try, but the Flyers actually played the Rangers very well when they had really no business taking them to 7 games. On the backs of Claude
Giroux. We're talking about Claude Giroux here. Where's Claude? What did he do in this series? Tell me what he did in this series.
He had a bad series this series, but you can't say
again. That's
what
I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the team. I'm talking about Claude Giroux.
Sean, you're wrong. He's been a playoff performer every single time he's been on the playoffs since this year.
Let's talk about Ghost. Ghost looks really good, right?
All right, so wait. So,
what about?
Sarah?
It depends on timing more than anything. If they can win a Stanley Cup, in 3 to 4 years, like they're supposed to, maybe, then I'd say Witt. If it takes longer than that, whatever.
Good stuff. Let's go to the Sixers. Will they be Witt or without Brett Brown as the head coach by the end of next season?
Not this season.
That's not even right. I'm going to go without. You know it. Clinton's going to come right here. They're going to bring in their own guys. I'm going without.
Wow. Okay.
And I'm a Brett Brown guy. Well, I'm here.
I'm the same way, bro. I see the same way.
Well, I don't think it bodes well. There's a lot of stuff going on, but I'll tell you, I'll give you one, the Lakers. Like, it was Byron Scott the last 2 years. It's his fault that garbage roster couldn't win a game. And guess what? He's went out.
He was on the Kobe Award Tour.
Exactly.
Come on, man. You know what he had? Meta World Peace. Was a starting
Swaggy P. Swaggy
P. Award Meta World Peace.
Exactly.
Come on, you get that guy that? Come on.
All right, finally, will the Phillies finish this season with or without at least 75 wins? 75.
Oh, I'm going to go under on that.
Okay.
Yeah,
so without.
Without. Give me the without on that. Because Vegas had about 65, 66. I think it was.
Yeah.
So I said 74, 75 around that number, so it's funny you guys put it there. I'll go under.
Just okay.
All right.
Sean, appreciate it. Man.
Appreciate it, yes.
Good stuff.
You know what? We're logging this. They'll bring this up to you years later.
I love it.
They brought up stuff that I've done. Not years,
memories like elephants on the show, my friend.
All right. Good to see you as always.